Hello and welcome back. Thank you so much for your comments on my previous video. Today I've got 10 underrated gems for you. Albums from bands and artists that I think that history has not done them justice and that they deserve greater recognition from us all. Albums that I think that should be handed down to future generations, and however successful they were at the time, today they don't belong to the usual suspects, to the war horses that get remastered over and over again. So the good thing about it is that we can, just pick them up for very silly money and enjoy really good music. So let's get into it. If you're new to the channel, please consider subscribing and become part of a family. First one, it's a soundtrack. Curtis Mayfield from the movie Superfly. This was 1972. I won't make any considerations about the movie itself because what I'm interested here is in the music. This is superb funk music, instrumental mainly, but very powerful with a very funky feeling. The sound on this copy is amazing. It's got a great sound stage and it's really timeless music. It represents a time where, when soundtracks were really important, and people bought the albums as well as watching the movie. This is a 1972 U.S. pressing, right? I know it because of the cutout here on the top right corner. This was items that were sent back to the recording company because they were unsold in shops and stores. So I bought this one over here, and American copies are plentiful, so settle for one of these, right? This is the label. It's an RSO, Robert Stewart, and as I said, for very little money you can enjoy great music. We're moving now to the UK, to a band that only lasted for a year, and I wouldn't call it a one-hit wonder, but a one-album wonder rather, right? It was Thunderclap Newman. The album is Hollywood Dream. It has a different cover in the US. And this band was produced by Pete Townshend, who also played bass on the album, right? I think it's a very interesting album, not only to Who's fans, but to people who like rock music from the late 60s and early 70s. The sound is phenomenal, it's very well recorded. It's a gatefold with lots of pictures and information about it, but unfortunately this band was short-lived, and of course Pete Townshend returned to The Who. The single Hollywood Dream was a minor hit in the States, but nobody paid much attention to the album itself, so I think it's time to vindicate this music. Back to the States. Creedence Clearwater Revival were immensely popular. John Fogerty is considered one of the great songwriters of all time. But when the band split up, when they disbanded, John Fogerty went solo, and some of his compositions became rock anthems, right? Played in arena rocks by different bands. And it's songs where we all know and have become staples, right, in many radio stations. By the mid 70s he released this album, John Fogerty, It's incredibly inexpensive. You can find it in the $1 bin or the $5 bin or £5 bin, whatever. And just, you know, just to tell you some few of the tracks here, Rocking All Over the World has been played for so many bands over the years, Flying Away, and my favorite, Almost Saturday Night. Fantastic music by John Fogerty. Mine is a UK first pressing, but you can get US first pressings as well for very little money and have a good time listening to this album. This should be a timeless classic. Moving up in the States to Detroit, Motown, The Temptations, right? I love the 70s period of The Temptations. Is when they merged psychedelic music with rock and funky music, and they made great, great albums, right? This is one of them, Psychedelic Shack. Tracks here like Friendship Train, It's Summer, and most importantly, War, right? That was later covered by Bruce Springsteen, but I don't think it beats the original here, right? And it sends a message, conveys a message that is true today, that as has always been, right? Unfortunately. Try and get the US Gordy. It's not difficult, right? Because other copies don't sound as good, right? I'll show you the Gordy label, this one. And you can get them both in the States and over here, because lots of American copies were shipped over at the time during the 70s, and they shouldn't be too expensive. You can also get the Dutch copy or the UK copy. They sound really, really good. But for my money, I would just go with the US first pressing. Now, back to Britain, Mr. Joe Cocker. Joe Cocker was very popular in 1969, 1970, 1971, right? And people my age and or people over 65 remember that very first Joe Cocker. Then the man, unfortunately, had issues with the booze, and we never heard back from him till the early 80s with that film. What was the name? 9 Weeks and a Half, where there was a track called You Can Leave Your Head On. And that made him popular again. And he had a few hits in a row and became popular to later generations. But from the early days, he's got this concert, this live concert, Mad Dogs and Englishmen, that is never mentioned when people talk about, when critics talk about live albums. And I think this is top, right? This is one of the live albums that everyone should have. You get here people like Leon Russell on guitar, Chris Staton on piano, Gene Gordon on drums. There's no filler. You get a version of Honky Tonk Women, Cry Me a River, Bird on the Wire, Feeling All Right. I mean, Give Peace a Chance, She Came In Through the Bathroom Window. My favorite, The Letter. It's a gatefold with pictures and stories, inexpensive, and sounds phenomenal, sounds tremendous. Another British band, Free. Free were, they seem to be transcend as a one-hit wonder, mainly because of the last track here on side two, All Right Now, that made them some money. But nobody paid much attention to their individual albums, right? And this one, Fire and Water, I think is a brilliant album, and it deserves to be up there with you know, with the top dogs. Tracks like Fire and Water, Heavy Load, Don't Say You Love Me are fantastic, right? This is inexpensive. It was released on Ireland. This is West Germany first pressing, but you can get UK first pressings, US first pressings. Fantastic music, very symbolic, and And that's where they belong to a time when bands knew the trade, right? Another similar situation was another similar band was Spooky Tooth, right? That was relatively famous for a year or two, and then they just vanished into thin air. One of their albums, this one, The Last Puff, featuring Mike Harrison, is amazing. Only the first track, I Am the Walrus, the Beatles song, is their cover is worth the price of admission. It sounds tremendous, right? It is very well recorded, it has a great presence, and the music is to die for. You have also got Chris Staton here on piano, he's doing the last part, the last song on side two. And the whole album flies by, right? It grows on you immediately, and you get it on constant rotation. If you can't get a US or a UK first pressing, well, get a later island copy from the late 70s and you'll be all right. My copy, this West German copy, sounds phenomenal. I never felt the need to upgrade. Back to the States and jazz. I'm not a jazz fan. I don't have the training, and I don't belong there. But there are a few jazz albums that I really like, and those I like, I worship them, I adore them. This is the case of this one, Archie Shepp and Horace Parlan, Going Home. This is one of my favorite jazz albums and one of my favorite albums, right? It's American gospels played on sax and piano. This music is incredible. It wrenches your soul. It wrenches your heart. I've never heard American gospel standards sound like they do sound on these albums. This is phenomenal music, played late in the evening, and you'll be absolutely delighted. So far as I know, it's never been reissued, but there are US copies around, not very expensive. And this side of the pond, you've got Dutch copies from Steeplechase, I think. That, you know, that are affordable, right? It's one of my Desert Island records. Now, back to Britain again, the Moody Blues. I don't think that history has done justice to this band. Days of Future Past was quite successful. Night in White Satin became a hit. But they never made it to the top 10 bands, right? And I think that's unfair, because their core albums from 1968 to 1972 are incredible. I've got them all, and I play them regularly, and I don't think critics have done justice to this band. The good thing about it is that they're very inexpensive. And my experience, I got different copies, but my experience is that the US first pressings and Canada first pressings for these albums are a tad better than the UK, right? If your experience is different, well, just prove me wrong, right? This is a Canadian first pressing, gatefold, and sounds phenomenal, much better than Days of Future Past, and the seven albums from the core period with Justin Hayward are incredible. And last but not least, Oh Stewart, Year of the Cat. Yes, I know what you're thinking, right? You're fed up with the song, right? The title track was all over the place in 76, 77. It got much radio play, and everybody knows the single, and On the Border that came out as a single as well. But nobody paid much attention to the album as a whole, as an entity. It went to the top five. Yes, it was top five in the States, right? So the album was really popular in the States, but elsewhere, you know, never made it. He became famous because of the song, but people didn't pay much attention to the album. So I just want to vindicate this album and give it credit. There's no filler here. All the songs sound great. The writing is phenomenal, based on historical facts, mystery, the very compelling lyrics. Songs are really catchy, very well produced. This album was produced by Alan Parsons. It's audiophile quality. I've heard the this is the German first pressing. I've heard the UK first pressing, the American first pressing. They all sound phenomenal. The MoFi CD sounds phenomenal. The early CD sounds phenomenal because this album is very, very well recorded, and it's a demo disc, right? It's a demo disc. So don't know why, but people should, you know, and critics should give credit to this album and to his and the next one, which was Time Passages, right? Which is also which is a great album as well. Right, and well, that's all for today. I hope you like my choices. Feel free to add any others on the comments. Thanks for listening. Thanks for your time. Take care.